JFT Just Fair and Direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's weekly market outlook webinar for the week May the 18th until May the 22nd. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will describe the most important economic releases and events on the financial agenda for the week ahead. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, there are no central bank meetings on this week's agenda, but we do get the minutes from the latest RBA and FOMC policy gatherings, from which we may get more clues as to how willing these two banks are to expand or not their easing efforts. We also get the UK and Canadian CPIs for April, as well as the preliminary PMIs for May from the Eurozone, the UK, and the US. So let's begin with Monday. On Monday, there are no major indicators or events scheduled to be released. The only one worth mentioning is Japan's GDP for the first quarter, which is already out. The data revealed that the Japanese economy contracted 0.9% quarter over quarter, officially slipping into a technical recession. However, the actual print was better than the minus 1.2% forecast, and perhaps that's why we didn't have a major market reaction. During the Asian morning, Asian indices traded in the green territory, and this may have been due to the slowdown in both infected cases and deaths from the coronavirus during the weekend. This may have raised hopes that the easing of restrictive measures around the globe would help the world to slowly emerge from a recession. Now on Tuesday during the Asian morning, we get the minutes from the latest RBA policy decision. At that gathering, the bank kept its cash rate and the target of its three-year government bond yield at 0.25%, with officials noting that they have scaled back the size and frequency of their bond purchases. However, they added that they are prepared to scale up these purchases if deemed necessary. Following the disappointment in Australia's employment data for April, we will scan the minutes to see how willing officials were to scale back up their QE purchases. A dovish flavor may raise speculation that this can be done as soon as at the June gathering and may hurt the Aussie. On the other hand, if the minutes suggest that scaling back up quantitative easing will be considered only under extreme circumstances, then the Aussie is likely to gain and perhaps outperform currencies, the central banks of which are expected to proceed with further stimulus in the months to come, like the pound and the kiwi. Now, during the European morning, we get the UK employment data for March. The unemployment rate is expected to have increased to 4.4% from 4%, while average weekly earnings, including bonuses, are expected to have slowed to 2.7% year over year from 2.8%. The excluding bonuses rate is also anticipated to have slid to 2.6% from 2.9%. Now, the case for a notable rise in the unemployment rate is supported by the KPMG and REC UK report on jobs for the month of March, which noted that both permanent placements and temporary billings fell at the steepest rates since 2009. Now, in the report, it was also noted that the increasingly uncertain outlook and the reduced demand for staff weighed on pay growth, which supports the case for declines in both the official wages rates. Now, from Germany, we have the ZW survey for May. The current conditions index is expected to have improved somewhat, but to have remained into negative waters. Specifically, it is expected to have increased to -87.8 from -91.5. The economic sentiment index is also expected to have risen to 33.5 from 28.2. Now, the overall picture with regards to the coronavirus suggests flattening curve since early April. As I already know that we had another round of slowdown during the weekend on both infected cases and deaths. So, somewhat more optimistic view by analysts, according to the ZW survey, appears more than normal to us. In the US, building permits and housing starts, both for April, are due to be released. Expectations are for both permits and starts to have declined to 1 million and 0.95 million from 1.35 million and 1.22 million, respectively. Now, on Wednesday, we get more minutes, this time those from the latest FOMC gathering. What happened back at the previous FOMC meeting? The committee kept interest rates unchanged at the 0 to 0.25% range and hinted that more stimulus may be delivered if judged necessary. We will continue to use powers proactively until we are confident that the US is solidly on the road to recovery, as Chair Powell noted back then. He also added that economic activity will likely drop at an unprecedented pace in the second quarter, which suggests that they are more likely to act again than not. We will look into the minutes for clues of how likely further action is and what form it could take, but we don't expect the minutes this time around to prove a major market mover. Why? We already got an updated view on monetary policy by several Fed officials recently, including Fed Chair Powell last week, who warned over an extended period of weak growth and stagnant incomes due to the pandemic, but who also made it clear that he and his colleagues are unlikely to push interest rates below zero. Remember that a couple of weeks ago, investors have started to price in such a likelihood, the likelihood of negative interest rates in the US, by pushing the yields of the Fed fund futures into the negative territory. Still, watching this chart here, we see that some yields are still in the negative zone, and according to those yields, there is a nearly 60% chance for interest rates to turn negative by summer next year. So it remains to be seen whether the FOMC is willing to act again and what form such an action could take. Fed Chair Powell and several other members commented against the negative rates, or let's say that they are not willing to cut rates into negative territory, but the market seems to still assign some probability on that scenario. Now, as for Wednesday's data, the UK CPIs for April are due to be released. We get inflation data from the UK. The headline rate is expected to have fallen to 0.8% from 1.5%, while the core one is anticipated to have slipped to 1.4% from 1.6%. So the fact that the core rate is expected to have declined by less than the headline one suggests that this may be due to the collapse in oil prices. Remember that the difference between the headline and core inflation metrics is volatile items like energy. So if we take the spread between the headline and the core rate, which is the gray line on this graph, you can see that this is tracking pretty well the year-over-year change in WTI prices, in Brent oil prices, excuse me, not WTI. And the latest tumble in oil brought that year-over-year rate pretty, let's say, well into the negative territory, suggesting that If the core rate is to slide somewhat, the headline rate is likely to slide by more. So the spread will turn well negative if this is the case. Now, what does this mean in terms of pound reaction and Bank of England and the Bank of England policy plans? This is likely, in my view, this data is unlikely to change speculation over the Bank of England's monetary policy plans. At its latest meeting, the bank kept the overall policy unchanged, but noted that the current QE is set to reach its target at the beginning of July. So it's too early for the bank to stop QE. And if they reach their target in July, they would need to expand QE, and maybe this will be signaled and telegraphed at the June meeting. So, combined with officials' readiness to take further action, we expect a QE expansion, maybe as soon as at the June meeting, something that would prove negative for the pound. Further stimulus is negative for the respective currency. Eurozone's final CPIs for April are also coming out, but as it is always the case, they are expected to confirm their initial estimates. So, final CPIs in the Eurozone are not market movers at all, because the market tends to pay more attention to the preliminary estimates, and usually the final prints are confirming those initial estimates. We don't have major deviations from the first forecasts. Now, we get inflation data for April later in the day. We get more inflation data, this time from Canada. The headline CPI rate is expected to have fallen into the negative territory. So the headline rate is expected to show deflation, -0.1% year over year from +0.9%, while no forecast is currently available for the core rate. Now, as with the UK CPI, due to the collapse in oil prices, we expect the core rate to have slipped by less than the headline rate. Again, we have the spread between the headline and core CPI rates from Canada, and this time we have the spread tracking the year-over-year change of WTI. You can see that when the year-over-year of the WTI turned negative, we had negative spread, which means a lower headline rate than the core rate, and this could be the case here as well. You can see the slump in the headline rate. So given that we had further declines in the year-over-year change of WTI, the headline rate will probably fall again by much more than the core one could slide. Now, what does this mean in terms of Bank of Canada decisions? At its prior gathering, Bank of Canada announced an expansion of its QE purchases and a potential negative inflation rate, as it is expected by this data, combined with further slide below the bank's objective of 2% in the core metric, may increase speculation for more easing by this bank. So we had the Bank of Canada expanding its QE at the previous meeting. This data may raise speculation for more easing, which could thereby bring the Canadian dollar under selling interest. Now, on Thursday, we don't get any major report on data. We get the preliminary PMIs for May from the UK and the US. No forecast is available for the UK numbers, while in the US, both the manufacturing and services indices are expected to have rebounded to 37.8 from 30, and excuse me, to 37.8 and 30 from 36.1 and 26.7 respectively. We also get the US existing home sales for April, which are forecast to have slid 19.4% after an 8.5% decline in March. So usually the PMIs move the markets, but in the case of the UK data, at this moment we don't have forecasts, so we'll have to wait up until Thursday to see if we will get forecasts on that front. In the US, we have expectations of a small rebound in both the manufacturing and services indices, but still The numbers will be well below the equilibrium line of on 50, and they are unlikely to raise speculation that the economy has recovered or has rebounded, and that no more action by the Fed is needed. After all, a couple of weeks ago, and Fed Chair Powell said that they remain willing to do what is necessary to stimulate the economy. And he also said that a rebound is not expected by year end or next year. So finally, on Friday, during the Asian morning, we have New Zealand's retail sales for the first quarter and Japan's national CPIs for April. No forecast is available for New Zealand's data, neither for Japan's headline CPI. We only have a forecast for Japan's core CPI rate, which is expected to have slipped to minus 0.1% from 0.4%. Now, during the European morning, we get more retail sales data, this time from the UK. Headline sales are forecast to have tumbled 16.5% month over month after declining 5.1%, while core sales are forecast to have fallen 15% month over month after sliding 3.7%. This would drive both the year-over-year rates down to minus 22.2 and minus 18.6 from minus 5.8 and minus 4.1, respectively. So expectations are for worse retail sales data in April than the already bad prints we got for March. However, if we take into account the year-over-year BRC retail sales monitor, however, if we take into account that the year-over-year rate of the BRC retail sales monitor rebounded to 5.7% from minus 3.5%, we would consider the risks surrounding the official prints as tilted to the downside. But again, even if we do get better retail sales data, this is unlikely to change expectations around the Bank of England's future policy plans. There is expectation that the bank could again expand its QE program. They said that the program will reach its target in July, so they most probably have to expand it again, and perhaps as early as at the June meeting. So even if we get better retail sales data from the UK, I don't believe that this will affect much expectations around the Bank of England policy plans. And if the pound rebounds on that data, any rally is likely to remain short-lived. Now, later, we get preliminary PMIs for May from several euro area members, as well as from the bloc as a whole. Both Eurozone's manufacturing and services indices are expected to have rebounded to 38 and 25 after hitting record lows at 33.4 and 12, respectively. This will drive the composite PMI up to 24 from 13.6. Although this data would point to an improvement, all readings would still be below the boom or bust barrier of 50, and thus they are unlikely to provide a massive boost for the euro. In terms of the ECB, when they last met, policymakers eased their conditions of their TLTROs and introduced a new series of non-targeted pandemic emergency long-term refinancing operations called PELTROs. So we have further easing in the TLTROs and an introduction of new refinancing operations, the PELTROs, due to the pandemic. And also, officials said that they are ready to adjust all of their instruments as appropriate to ensure that inflation moves towards the aim in a sustainable manner. Now, with the ECB ready to do whatever is necessary to support the euro area economy, even if the PMI is rebound, we don't expect this to affect the current view around policy. We believe that the PMIs could just keep the door for further stimulus wide open, even if we see some improvement. Now, finally, we get Canada's retail sales for March. Headline sales are expected to have tumbled 10% month over month after rising 0.3%, while the core rate is anticipated to have risen to minus 5% from minus 15.6%. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. At this point, we'll leave you a few seconds to write to me any questions you may have on the week ahead and the markets. Do we have any questions? Okay, we have a question here. What's my view on GBP/USD and Euro sterling? Okay, here, those pairs are very tricky now, and I will explain why. Okay, let's start with cable. Here we have the pound, which is exposed to further easing by the Bank of England. And we also have the dollar, which is mainly affected by recently, let's say, by the broader market sentiment. So if the broader market sentiment improves, or let's say continues to improve, because we had an improvement in market sentiment yesterday, this would be negative for the US dollar, which acts as a safe haven. Okay. And so it will be a battle between the pound and the dollar, which currency will weaken the most. In my view, given that the pound also carries the risks, the Brexit risks, as we get closer to December, the pound is likely to start getting more volatile on Brexit headlines. Remember that Prime Minister Johnson is sticking to its guns that there will not be an extension, and the deadline for the transition period should be on December. So we are getting towards December. We are getting closer, but no progress is being made between negotiations, let's say negotiations between the UK and Europe. So in my opinion, the pound is likely to suffer more than the dollar. The dollar could still rebound if fears surrounding the coronavirus resurface. So I don't see any clear reasons for the pound to strengthen, to be honest. So I would keep a negative view on GBP/USD. So with regards to euro sterling now, here, as I said, with regards to the pound, I am negative overall, but the big question is whether the pound could underperform the euro, because the euro could still stay under some selling interest due to expectations of further stimulus by the ECB. But I believe that those expectations are overall priced in. And if we look at the technical picture, recently we had a rally above the 0.88, let's say 88.80 zone, 88.78 zone. Let's put it there. It was the upper bound of a sideways range that's been in place since the beginning of April. So I would lean to the positive side of euro sterling. So I'm negative on cable, but positive on euro sterling. I am negative overall to the pound. Technically, on euro sterling, we had a sideways range between 88.70, let's say, and 85.90. This has been in place since the beginning of April. And on Friday, we saw a good push above the upper bound of the range. So this technically paints a positive picture and combined with my fundamental outlook for a weaker pound due to the reasons I already mentioned, I would expect Euro GBP to go higher. So that's it. Any other questions? Do you have any other questions? Okay. Whether I see a double top on GBP USD technical. Okay. Let me have the chart. Take the chart. Let me see the chart of GBP USD. Just give me. Okay. I wouldn't say that it's a normal double top. We have two tops forming at 126.45 around there. The previous top was at around 125.30. And let's say it's a complex double top because we have, instead of two clear tops, we have another one in another one lower. But yeah, the break below the, if we take the 120-235 zone as the neckline of the double top, the rate has already breached that zone. I think the clear break was on Wednesday or Thursday, and on Friday we saw the acceleration to the downside. So technically, this is a completion of, let's say, a reversal pattern or a double top, if you want to name it, and between the neckline at around 122.35, 122.40, around there. So, yeah, today we see that the pound is rebounding slightly, but as long as it remains below, as long as cable remains below the neckline of the double top, I would stay bearish on that, and maybe the bears will. Maybe they will decide to take charge again if the rate continues higher and tests the neckline of the double top. So any more questions? Yeah, the double top is more visible, let's say, on the daily chart. So we don't have any other questions. Thank you very much for staying here with me for up until the end, for watching, for listening. I hope you have a great day. For those who are interested in more frequent analysis, I'm holding daily videos, daily market review videos from Tuesday up until Friday. You can find those videos on YouTube at around 7:30 a.m. GMT time, sometimes earlier. But if you subscribe to our YouTube channel, you will be informed. And yeah, if you want to see more detailed, more frequent analysis, explaining what's happening during the week that is not on the economic schedule, you can find those videos. You may find them useful. So thank you very much. Have a great day and great week. And I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next Monday.
JFT, just fair and direct.